I'm going to start recording our call, our webinar, and give everybody that's here so far a warm welcome. And thank you for being with us today on part two of the Color of Our Future Conversation series. Jeffrey Ann Wilder, one of our researchers, is going to be facilitating, along with Dr. Lisa Baker, Barker, our conversation today. So I'll go ahead and start sharing my screen. Keep an eye out on the chat, as Lisa mentioned earlier, where we either you can not just introduce yourselves, but if you have something to add to some of the questions that we will have throughout our call today, you feel free to drop your answers there. So, Jeffrey Ann, I'm going to tee it off to you to get us started today.
Well, thank you so much, Johnny, and welcome everyone. As Johnny mentioned, my name is Jeffrey Ann Wilder. I am on the research team at NCWIT. I'm a sociologist by training, and I'm very excited to be sort of launching our second installment of our conversation series on Black women and girls in tech. And today's conversation, as you all know, is devoted to Black women in post-secondary computing education. So we could go ahead, I'll share with you all a brief overview of our day. So Johnny just gave us the welcome. I'm gonna spend a little bit of time talking about our series and why it's important for us to be looking at the experiences of Black women in post-secondary higher education. I will introduce our esteemed panelists and our esteemed facilitator, Dr. Lisa Barker. Then we will jump into our questions for our panelists, followed by our Q&A, and then we will wrap it up. And again, welcome. So this is our, we're pausing here for our welcome slide to welcome in. I see we now have 44 participants who are a part of this conversation, which is very, very exciting. So I just like to take a quick moment to talk a little bit about the importance of this particular initiative. So of course, at NCWIT, our goal is to increase the meaningful and influential participation, broaden the meaningful and influential participation of women and girls in computing. And for those folks who may not be familiar with, 100% familiar with the work that we do here at NCWIT, we operate using a three-pronged strategy to convene, equip, and unite in order to improve awareness and knowledge, and of course to motivate change leaders. We convene through our annual summit, which occurs in May, and also through our five alliances. We equip through a large number of free online research-based resources, and I'll be pointing to some of our resources that are more geared toward the experiences of women of color in post-secondary education a little bit later. And we unite through a variety of our programs and initiatives, such as our Aspirations in Computing program, our Counselors for Computing program, Technolachicas, and a wide variety of other initiatives related to broadening participation. So this is a really, really exciting series. So the Color of Our Future is really looking at the future of tech. We know how important technology is now and will continue to be on into the future. And our goal in this conversation series, which of course we are, it's hard to believe that we're here at the end of February, but here we are during Black History Month, and also as we go into the next month of March, Women's History Month. We are spending our time through the Color of Our Future Conversation series, really celebrating what Black women and girls have done in computing and looking for ways to continue to broaden their participation within tech. So that is through a three-part series. 2 weeks ago, we had our K-12 conversation, which was absolutely outstanding. And we know that today will be just as outstanding, if not more. And in a few weeks, on March 12th, we'll be looking at the experiences of Black women in the tech workforce. And so throughout each of these conversations, we want to explore pertinent issues and solutions and ways in which to enhance the experiences of Black women and girls across the entire tech ecosystem. Why is looking at Black women in post-secondary education, computing education, important? Because even though women remain underrepresented in computing education, there is even more of a critical gap, critical shortage need, if you will, for women of color, particularly Black women earning computing degrees across the post-secondary computing landscape. So just a couple of statistics here that we get from this really fantastic resource from the Kapor Center. Their Women of Color in Computing Data Brief. There's a link here. It really is an excellent resource if you want to know more about women and girls of color across the tech landscape. So 3% of bachelor's degree earners out of the percentage of female degree earners were Black women, and 2% of doctoral degree recipients are Black women. So of course there is still a long way for us to go, and definitely a need to address the ways in which we can continue to bring folks in and to be more inclusive and equitable within post-secondary education. But this conversation doesn't just stop with this series, if we could go to the next slide. We're not going to stop here. The Color of Our Future, even though we're launching this conversation series, our goal is to continue the conversation, to continue looking at how we can positively impact the color of our future within tech, because we know that computing pathways certainly can bridge the gap within the economic, the social, and political and cultural landscapes for women and girls of color now and on into the future. So the color of our future is really an organizational strategy here at NCWIT that we use to anchor our broader programs, initiatives, and our resources that are focused on broadening the meaningful and influential participation of all underrepresented women and girls of color, inclusive of Black, Latinx, and Native American women, again, so we can ensure that we are positively impacting the future of computing. Okay, so what I'd like to do now is take a moment to highlight, as I mentioned before, our absolutely phenomenal panel today. So first, if you could wave a hand, Deborah. I don't know if folks can see Deborah because she's not quite talking yet, but Deborah Kariuki is a faculty member at the University of Maryland in Baltimore City. She is currently working there, and she is tasked with something pretty phenomenal. So her work revolves around creating a computer science education master's program in order to prepare effective and leader teachers to teach computer science into the next generation, effective this coming fall of 2020. So the computer science content that Deborah is working on is the first and only program of its kind in the state of Maryland, which is quite formidable. And this content area was created in response to the Maryland state mandate for a computer science teacher to be in place at 100% of Maryland high schools by next year in 2021. So with that, we will welcome Deborah Kariuki, our first panelist. Our second panelist is Dr. Allison Scott, whose role is Chief Research Officer at the Kapor Center. So Dr. Allison Scott works at the Kapor Center, which is a family of organizations devoted to making the tech ecosystem and entrepreneurship more diverse and inclusive. Through her role as a Chief Research Officer, Dr. Scott leads a research team aiming to enhance diversity in the tech ecosystem through conducting landscape studies and research on interventions within educational settings and the tech workplace, and also through the dissemination of effective research-based strategies, resources, and practices across the tech ecosystem. Dr. Scott is also a committee member is represented on a nationwide committee addressing the underrepresentation of women in tech through the National Academies, and hopefully she can spend a little bit more time talking about her role specifically with that committee today throughout the course of the panel. So thank you so much, Dr. Scott, for joining us. And finally, last but not least, we have Dr. Cheryl A. Soignier, who's an associate professor of computer science at Claflin University, where she is named the Henry N. and Alice Carson Tisdale Endowed Professor. Dr. Soignier conducts research in human-computer interaction with an emphasis in visual programming of educational simulations with end-user programming educational gaming technologies. That sounds really great, and hopefully, Cheryl, you can tell us more about that, because I really don't have much idea about what exactly that means. So thank you all for joining our panel. And at this point, I'd like to hand it off to Dr. Licia Barker, who is a senior research scientist with us at NCWIT and also an associate professor of information science at CU Boulder.
Thank you. And I just want to let everyone on the call know that you have been muted by our tech support, Johnny, today. And so if you want to ask a question or to speak, you'll have to unmute yourself first. You can also put your questions into the chat, and we'll be watching over the chat to see what questions that you have and responses to our panelists. I also want to thank the panelists for joining, incredible people. I'm so honored to be able to lead a conversation with you. So if you could change the slide, please, Johnny. Thank you. So our first question today is, our goal in this conversation is to empower and advocate for the inclusion of more Black girls and women in computing. So let's begin by having each panelist celebrate one program or initiative or an individual whom you feel has served as a change agent in broadening the participation of Black women in post-secondary computing. And I'm going to leave it to you to decide who's going to speak first, because I'm sure you all have people to talk to about.
All right. This is Deborah, and I'm going to go ahead and start. Thank you so much, Dr. Retrice. We've known each other for a while, since the days in Texas. So I appreciate that. But one person that I can say that I've been so impressed with, and her foster of computer science education for Black girls and Black women, is Dr. Kayla, in the first woman to get her PhD in University of Michigan. She has done so much. She has a podcast. She has National Center for Black Computing. I'm sure I'm not saying that right, but she has so many programs going around. And it was because of her that I got to realize there were so many other Black women around that I had not met. I spent 16 years at IBM as a software engineer, and I really wasn't sure there were that many Black women in computer science. I hadn't known. You know, that 3% is quite a big number, but I didn't know where they all are. And she has been bringing them together. So she's doing a really great job. And of course, I've been so impressed with NCWIT and what they have done. That's how I first got involved with really encouraging girls into computer science, was through the initiative of NCWIT, them having to apply for the Aspiration Award, and that made a big difference.
Can I interject for a second? I'm so sorry to interject. I know that folks are probably want to know more about the person that you mentioned, Deborah. And everyone, Deborah is talking about Dr. Kyla McMullen, who is an assistant professor at the University of Florida, and she was the first Black woman to complete her PhD in computer science from the University of Michigan just a few short years ago, maybe in 2014 or 2015, perhaps. She's also one of the co-hosts of the Modern Figures podcast. So I am not going to interrupt anymore. I'm going to throw her info in the chat, but I just want to make sure that everyone knew who Kyla is. And Kyla is, I think, even under 35 years old. So she is very, very impressive and definitely going to be impacting the world of computing for a really, really long time. So sorry about that interruption. I'll just go ahead and go to chat.
Thank you. I had forgotten a couple of things. So thank you for adding that information.
You're welcome.
Oh, yeah. So I wanted to interject here. Don't mean to toot my own horn here, but I started a foundation a few years ago called the CIS Foundation, but for the past 12 to 14 years, I've been doing the work of a change agent in terms of increasing the number of underrepresented minorities including women and girls in computing. And one particular program that I have is called Cool Girls Code, where we work with girls in middle school and high school, and we teach them how to write code, how to build websites, and also how to program robots. And so I've been doing this with organizations such as Girls Inc., working with those young girls. I've also been working with girls at the Boys and Girls Club, as well as local middle schools and high schools, in order to create that pipeline from K-12 into post-secondary education. There are other programs that are similar to mine. Kimberly Bryant, who has Black Girls Code, and Kimberly Bryant is a dear friend of mine, and she's out there on the West Coast in the Bay Area, and I believe she's in San Francisco, but she has chapters of Black Girls Code all over the nation, and she seeks to increase the number of underrepresented girls in computing as well.
And this is Allison. I would just add, I'm actually going to add two really quick, very promising initiatives. The first, Black Compute Her, is something that I've watched the community grow over the last couple years. So what I really appreciate about this initiative, which is led by three Black women, Jamaica Burge, Dakita Thomas, and Quincy Brown, is that what they've been able to do is build a network of Black women, mainly in the professional space, folks who are either working towards PhDs, who are in academia, or who are in the tech workforce. And each year their conference grows bigger and bigger, and that means the network gets bigger and bigger, and I think it's been really powerful to see. And then the second is the Reboot Representation Initiative, which is led by Dewana Franklin Davis. And so the thing that I think is really special about this initiative is that it has an intentional focus on women of color, not just gender diversity broadly, and it also has a specific goal, which is very aggressive, like we need to double the number of women of color by 2025. So I think both of those are amazing initiatives.
Thank you. And I promise this is the only question that I'm gonna jump in on, but I want to share some recognition for Dr. Valerie Taylor from Argonne National Labs. She has been involved in diversifying computing for women of color since at least 2000, if not before. So she just was recognized as a 2019 Distinguished Fellow for her technical work, but I don't want us to forget how much she's done for the community also. So
it's so great. We do have a lot of women, but I think we'd be amiss if we did not mention Brenda with Grace Hopper and what she's doing. She was the very first person who recognized CS for All. So she was the first to use the term CS for All in Chicago, and she really brought that initiative to bear. And now she's gone on to become the CEO of Anita Vogue and Grace Hopper, and that is fantastic. So she has also done a lot.
Thank you. Any last comments from our other two panelists? Okay, well, let's go on to the second question. In higher education, how are the issues faced by Black female faculty in tech departments different from that of Black female students? And what are some effective strategies for addressing the issues of each group?
Well, I like to start by responding to that particular question. As a Black woman in higher ed, you know, we face a lot of issues. But as I studied that particular question, I really don't think that there's much of a difference between undergraduate students and actually faculty in terms of the issues or concerns that they face in post-secondary education. I think at the faculty level, there may be more issues because they're at a different level, but there are some similar issues that Black women in higher ed face. According to some of the research that I've seen in my own personal experiences, Black women are sometimes exploited in many different ways. Sometimes they are given assignments that are mediocre. Maybe the salaries are not compatible. And sometimes when Black women make mistakes, oftentimes their mistakes are remembered as opposed to their colleagues or their counterparts, or maybe even their mistakes are even amplified as opposed to their counterparts. When they make mistakes, maybe their mistakes or their missteps are forgotten. I believe that Black women pay the ultimate social tax. What I mean by that is that we are the wives, we are the mothers, we're the sisters, we're the aunts. We do so many different things. We bear children, we parent, we take care of our loved ones when they're sick, our children, you know, our mothers and our fathers, and yet we still produce and we work hard to get things done, and we'll stay late into even the midnight hour trying to complete tasks and not even consider our own, you know, bodies. And we lack sometimes the self-care. But one way to resolve some of these issues is for administration to provide the support that is needed for Black women by creating various, you know, types of networks, and so that Black women can feel as if they are appreciated more in post-secondary education, because sometimes we may feel as if we're not, you know, getting the needed support in order for us to move to the next level. Another issue I wanted to address was sometimes we get that extra scrutiny. You know, maybe we are maybe micromanaged a little bit more than our counterparts. So, but if we can get the full support of administration and even colleagues, it would help, you know, make life in the academy even easier. And in terms of students feel sometimes that, hey, they're isolated, they feel alone. And again, we can provide support networks, and believe it or not, there are sororities on different college campuses, and in these sororities, students, particularly females, find a sense of community, commonality, friendships, fellowships. In these communities, you can also develop, you know, different collaborations as well.
So let me follow up really quickly, Dr. Soignier. It sounds like women faculty and women students have to go outside of the mainstream to feel a sense of support. And so it feels like a double bind where you have this extra tax to feel supported because the administration is not providing that support.
Well, definitely it is a double bind, at least in my case, being that I'm Black and female, and oftentimes I find my support external to the academy as opposed to internal, because I mean, some of the issues you face, you might not always want to share them with the people that you work with.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. What I would say is some of the issues that Black faculty or Black students face is isolation, just like Cheryl said, because usually you'll be one, you know, in a class they could be almost maybe 100 people, and it's just that one Black female student in a class. That is not a fun place. I remember those days when I went to class. So I always sat right in the front because I didn't want to look at all what was happening in front. I just wanted to pay my attention, get to know what I was there for, and then leave. And it's the same thing when you have students. And that's why I think it has been so good to have several organizations, Black Computer, Black Girls Who Can Code, NCWIT, and all the other organizations that have popped up, so that girls, Black girls who are in college now, or young women who are in college now, can have a sense of belonging, because that has not been there. For those of us who did computer science, we know that was not there. And that happens the same way when you're a faculty. You're it sometimes. It's just one of you. And you know how it is when people are talking about certain experiences they have had, and you did not have those experiences. So again, by that nature of people having some past experience and you did not have that, you don't have a contribution. So you feel alienated, not because maybe even people want to alienate you, it's just because your life experience was not the same. You did not go through the same paths. You did not have that same experience. The same thing is like even groups like sororities or fraternities and all those. When I came to this country, I had no idea what those were, so I did not join one. And that's the other thing. Depending with where somebody has come and what their background was, they might not know what some of those groups are, and so they don't join. And if you have to work and put yourself through school, you're not going to avail yourself to too many things happening on campus, even though that would be a good experience. And maybe you might even miss out on things like research because that is not paying, and you go take a job. And that means when you go to get jobs, then again, you're missing some of the aspects that would have helped you, because you had to make money to go to school. You did not do some of the research. It's good that there are more and more companies that are offering paid internship and really solid internships, like Google has stepped up, Facebook has stepped up, and many other programs going to HBCU, stepping up and bringing students on board. It's still a small number, but at least they get some really strong foundation of experience. So I would say, all in all, the experiences of a Black faculty and a Black female student would be the same experience that they would have, or any other underrepresented student. They would be find themselves alone. I'm sure that you'd hear the same information from a Native American or a Hispanic girl. Usually you're alone. And when people get together to go and study, and maybe they have, if they have joint sororities, they know professors, they know who to avoid, they know what past tests look like. You don't have those. So really, when Black women, Black girls go through computer science and they pass, you know very well they're highly qualified, even though a lot of companies don't want to put them where they should be. They don't start them there, but they are highly qualified because they had to do it on their own to get where they got. So that was my experience, and also that's the same experience I'm seeing, or I have seen on campuses.
And can I really quickly just build up on the two previous panelists? I totally agree with everything that's been stated, and I think the value of networks is incredibly important, both within the institutions, so like Black faculty across disciplines, for example, and also outside of the institutions. But really just want to lift up again the importance of having a professional network, and that applies to both students as they're going through the process and to faculty as they're also going through a similar process. And I really, really appreciate the comment about the burden on Black women and identifying what, because I think it's so important that we identify what the specific barriers are to different populations. And the more that we get precise about how those barriers might differ from other populations, I think the better that we can formulate solutions to address those. And then finally, I think it may have been kind of implicitly stated, but I think empowering Black women to lead is also something that could be an effective strategy for addressing those groups. So once we've identified the barriers, and then having Black women themselves lead those lead the solutions, whether through leadership positions, funding, et cetera, I think is incredibly important. And I know we'll get later on in the conversation to talk about how policies also need to change. If we're going to empower Black women to lead, then we have to also ensure that we're valuing that leadership in similar ways.
So let me lead us into the next question then, just to follow on with your comments. So you talked about understanding barriers in order to create solutions and also empowering Black women to lead. So what are some areas of opportunity across the post-secondary landscape for strengthening the meaningful and influential participation of underrepresented women of color, Black women in particular, in academic computing pathways? You might as well start, Dr. Scott.
Okay, sure, I'm happy to start. So I think there are a couple areas of opportunity. One that I think is really important, I think oftentimes we have these conversations and we get siloed into the stage of the pipeline, like, are we talking about K-12 or are we talking about higher ed? I think it's important to focus on improving equity in CS education at the secondary level. And there are lots of initiatives, as we all know about, but I think we are missing a lot of Black girls who are dropping off before even entering into that, post-secondary computing pipeline. I like to always mention the stats here in California, just 39 Black girls took the AP exam in 2018. And so I think that's illustrative of how significant the problem is. So I think we need to focus there. And then at the higher ed post-secondary level, I think that there are lots of opportunities to think about additional pathways into tech. So there are the traditional computing pathways. There's some exciting, I think, initiatives out of sponsored by NSF around STEM plus computing. So how does computing touch all of these different areas that I think Black women have been typically more interested in or more represented in across disciplines across the campus? But computing, as we know, touches all of these disciplines. I think there's an opportunity there. And then the two other ideas that are not specific just to higher ed, but I think there's the need for a larger policy agenda. And I know Jeffrey Ann mentioned earlier that we are working on this through the National Academies Committee on the Underrepresentation of Women of Color in Tech. But a larger policy agenda that would address both at every level, right? At the federal level in terms of where funding is allocated, all the way to what policies look like in higher education institutions. But I do think that there's an opportunity for at least naming what some policies that we should be considering in order to move the needle for Black women in computing. And I'd love to hear what my other panelists think.
Yeah, that is a really good point. You talked about how many Black girls are actually taking the AP exam, because that kind of gives you a measure of all this initiative, that all this money is being spread all around the countries. So many states are putting money into computer science. What exactly is happening in the classroom that many of them are not taking that exam, even though they're doing the AP principal course? Several of them are not even passing. And that is where we start thinking about programs of how to prepare the teachers who are teaching the Black girls, so that those girls who are maybe in their classroom, how do they experience that classroom? Why do they feel that they don't want to participate, go forward, or don't even want to do the AP exam? Is it because the experience was not good? That means they're not going to continue. And that's not what we want. So having a good experience, having teachers who understand how to teach culturally sensitive will be very important, because I remember when I went through college, all the methods and everything was about the car, the tire, the bicycle, and some other terminologies that I had no clue what they were. So having teachers who are teaching students and giving them examples and giving them the leeway to work in things that make sense to them, that is going to help a lot. It's going to make a big difference in how they see computer science, how they approach it. We don't want many of them going through computer science and then turning out to say they hate it, just like many students in America say about math. So we need that experience to be a good experience in the classroom. And I hope the program that I'm creating will produce teachers who are very sensitive to how they teach computer science and going forward, because it's good to have exposure, but it's also good to have exposure that is meaningful, that is going to allow them to see themselves and want to go forward and not just have an experience just to have a check that we just experienced this. And so what does that do to their future? So that's what I had to add.
Thank you. Dr. Swania, you are muted.
When you talk about the AP exam, you have to look at the landscape in terms of the number of, you know, Black girls who enrolled in those courses. I had the pleasure of teaching at a high school, teaching Java programming course a few years ago. And I did not have one Black girl in that class. And so my point is, we have to engage girls early on. We can't wait until they get to the 10th, 11th, or 12th grade. We have to start when they're in elementary. We have to start when they're in middle school, introducing them to computing concepts, and also teaching them how to write code. And we can start with visual programming languages and then move on to object-oriented programming language. But it's imperative that we introduce them early on. And then maybe they'll, you know, get some interest in computing, and we'll see more girls and women in computing later on.
So all three of you mentioned things that I would call sort of a shortage of supply, like you're not getting the women into the undergrad programs. Is there anything you can do, without heading into the high school arena, is there anything you can do on campus to get women interested in taking an introductory course and to sort of recruit them in and then perhaps retain them there?
One thing that I did a few years ago, when I was at a prior university, I went to the freshman class and I introduced computing to them during their freshman orientation course that they have to take. And I tell them, you know, about the advantages of being in computing. And not only that, I brought in some of our top students in computing, and they introduced, you know, computing to the students in the orientation class, and they told them about their experiences. And not only that, they invited them to participate in the computing organizations. At the time, it was like National Society of Black Engineers, Association of Computing Machinery. And they also talked about, you know, their internship experiences, as well as, you know, the money that they made as a result of being, you know, in computing and working at different organizations during the summer or throughout the year.
Yeah, I think that that is a good idea to have them invited during their orientation. But in many universities, computer science is required in many majors. So having a good experience for that introduction of computer science course, that would make it good and relevant to them. And maybe they will continue to encourage their friends. They had the good experience, because usually you would find that people take courses because other people talked about it. They said what the experience they had. If they had a bad experience, they'll say, stay away from that. So it's good to talk to different universities whenever we are going to all sorts of different meetings to let them know that the introduction courses should be good experiences for all students, so that more and more students would stay. But to get them into that introduction class, that really would have to go down to high school. There's no way about it because they won't know that that is there. So if you're in Colorado and you're teaching at the Colorado University and you know students who are going to be coming to your school, then you go to the high schools around the university and you let them know what you offer, why is it interesting, and why should they take it. That because they need to be invited. Everybody likes to know that they're invited and they will have somebody who supports them because the person invited them. Otherwise, you will not get, people don't just decide last minute they're going to major in something. Most of the time these days, people come ready because they have to be there for 4 years, especially if they have financial aid and they're being told you need to be done in 4 years. So they come ready and set to finish something in 4 years. So it again, it falls back for us going lower. And like Cheryl said, that we can't wait for high school. We know the whole K through 12 computer science now is saying start computational thinking from when they're little. And as they go on, as they start getting to middle school, that's when you introduce the programming, but they have the language from when they're younger. So you do it as part of different classes, you put computational thinking. You're not going to be teaching preschoolers and second graders programming. Maybe they can do a little bit of drag and drop, but you're not going to be teaching a text language for those younger kids. But you want them to have the language and they know that this is coming as they go forward, just like we introduce math or we introduce English, we introduce computational thinking and we start talking, this is the language of computing. And as they go forward, they know that this is part of just something else they learn like any other subject.
Are there other comments, Dr. Swanier or Dr. Scott?
Can I add two quick additional ideas that I think are just worth mentioning as we talk about the pipeline, both K-12, high school, like going down earlier. I think there's also a missing piece that from a lot of conversations around the community colleges and how community colleges and the collaboration with community colleges can create additional pathways. And so I think that's a promising opportunity. And then I also just wanted to lift up one of the challenges that at least is very, very present, I think, here in California. I'm sure it's not any different across the country, which is the impacted majors and how having barriers to even entering into the computing major is creating a lot of additional barriers for all students, but really impacting students of color as well. And so if we have these arbitrary, that's like a policy item, but if we have arbitrary cutoffs like a 3.5 GPA or some sort of criteria to enter into a computing major, that might also be having a negative impact on who, even if the students have interest, so like the students who have demonstrated interest, have taken the programming courses, really want to major in CS, are there additional barriers to even getting them into the major?
I would like to comment on that. That's pretty interesting. I haven't seen that at HBCUs. I mean, for the most part, students get the opportunity to choose whatever their major is, regardless of their GPA. So now, you know, I did hear of that, and those types of restrictions can really discourage a student and, you know, and it negatively impacts retention. I know it would at HBCUs if you tell a student that they can't major, you know, in computing because they don't have a 3.5, and you would be really surprised, you know, if you allow these students who don't have a 3.5 to major in computing, they just might be the ones who get the great job. It doesn't necessarily have to be in Silicon Valley, but it could be on the East Coast at maybe a Spawor or a Boeing. So that's an interesting finding, you know, an interesting fact to know that there are schools of computing that don't allow students to get in because they don't have a 3.5. And the same thing kind of happens in K-12 as well, because most of the time it's the teachers who select the students to participate in those programming courses. You have to have a certain GPA. Are the more advanced courses or the honors, but technically by law, you know, in K-12, in public institutions, a student can take whatever class he or she desires, but it's just so interesting to see that that's going on in post-secondary education, and that will have a negative impact on Black students, definitely.
You know, there's another policy issue that can also affect this, you know, this huge enrollments that we've gotten, which is to say that students who are willing to declare the major at the outset will have seats in an intro class, where when students who just want to sample the class and see, maybe I like it, maybe I won't, will go to the bottom of the wait list or something. So I'm going to segue, having said that, I'm going to segue to question six because we're getting low on time. And, but I want to make the question a little bit broader about who's getting mentored or advised about what. So the question is, let's talk about the importance of mentorship, formal, informal, or peer, in the recruitment and retention and advancement of Black women in higher education. How do we build a culture of mentorship for Black women, especially for those who may be underrepresented in their programs and departments? And the question here is, what advice do we give department chairs or deans to provide proper support for women of color? And I would like to extend that to, what advice do we give to them about policies they may put in place that might limit who declares their major or who samples their major?
I mean, when it comes to who is getting mentored and who's being put out there, you see those by who is presenting, who's going to conferences, who's going to represent the school. You don't find a lot of school putting forward their women of color who are in their majors. And if you find a woman of color who's in a computer science major, you know they have overcome a lot. By the time they're seniors, they know exactly what they're doing. But if you find that when you see any conferences and you find that schools have sponsored certain students and you don't find that they're students of color, it's the same students who have been overly presented are the same ones who are always pushed forward to go and select. That means they were the ones who were mentored. That's the ones who had somebody who encouraged them. They were the ones who knew that such an event was happening. And so the women of color, and I'm talking about myself too, I've been going through computer science. I never knew about any conferences. I never heard about any. And it's not because that I was blind to it. I did have to put myself through college. So I had to work a lot. I worked all night, went to school all day. So that was the difference. But I never had anybody mention to me about any conferences or anything that I could do beyond my classwork. And maybe it's because I did not have a relationship with any professors, or they did not see where they would talk to me to tell me, you know, this happens and this is what you can do. Nobody even ever mentioned to me about any internships. Those were things that you would find on the career board. And we do know that professors are the ones who give certain names to certain companies because they know. And when the companies come asking, they know which students to push. So what we would tell a dean in computer science, first of all, don't have too many barriers. Maybe extend classes so you have more classes of people who want to sample computer science, because we know many universities say, we are full, we have 2,000 students, that's it, we are full. But then you have other courses that don't have enough students. So why not open those classrooms and bring a computer science professor? They will find them. I know there's a shortage, but if they really, really look, they could find a lot of adjuncts who could teach an intro class and make it available to as many students as possible. So a dean should know that women of color at their university are not well supported. Many professors have not gone out to know or even understand their experiences. And sometimes you wonder, where does a professor find this? But if we want to be honest and be equitable, we need to say, there's a reason they're not there. There's a reason they're being left behind. So what can we do? So we need to tell them. You need to just talk about this in a staff meeting. Just be open about it. Have these pointers during a staff meeting. How are we supporting our students of color? Who, and maybe what is their experience in our classroom? If you just see two of them or one of them, how are they viewing everything in this classroom? How have we given them tools to go out there and be successful? So that's what I would tell a dean to make it more equitable for those students of color.
Thank you. We've got 6 minutes, so I just wanted to point that out to our speakers. Dr. Scott and Dr. Soigne, what are your comments? Dr. Soigne, you are muted.
In terms of mentoring, I believe that professors should reach out to the students. We do that at HBCUs, and one way I mentor my students is by advising student organizations. I'm an advisor of the Association of Computer Machinery, as well as the National Society of Black Engineers. So we just don't talk about computing stuff. We also talk about their future. We talk about issues that they're facing, whether it's the imposter syndrome, where they don't feel like they're good enough, or even if they're having difficulty in another class, or how to proceed, you know, the next steps as it in respect to their major. So mentoring is so important. And so I advise other, you know, professors, hey, reach out to your students, try to work with them. In terms of our department chairs and our deans, support your faculty. Believe in your faculty. Let your faculty create, trust your faculty, be fair to your faculty, respect your faculty, encourage your faculty.
Beautifully stated. The only other thing I would add is just back to the how we incentivize or provide support for Black faculty who are the ones that are bearing the burden of providing all of the mentorship, and we want them to continue to do that. So I think valuing that in concrete ways is incredibly important. And speaking out from outside of academia, I think there are probably better ideas as to how to actually execute that, but I think that's a really important change that I would love to see.
Thank you. We have a few minutes for questions from the audience. And I would remind you to unmute yourself if you have a question.
Answer one question that was posted there about using AP as a metric. Even though we wouldn't use it that much as a metric since it's optional, we do know that there are many Black girls who do math calculus, and they do AP biology, and they do AP English. So if they can do AP calculus, many of them, then why can't they do AP principle, which is of much, much lower, competition compared to the calculus one. So that's all I have to say about that question, sorry.
We have a question. Do any of the panelists have or have had in the past mentors that were male or of different race?
Yes. In fact, I called a mentor yesterday regarding, you know, an issue that I was dealing with. And so it doesn't matter the race, as long as you get the support that you need. And so race should not matter.
Yes, I used to be it most of the time. When I started working for IBM, my mentors were male and they were not African-American. So I did get mentors who were not African-American and they were not female.
Thank you. Any final questions or comments? Well, I have I have a response from Wendy about the AP exam. It's just that there are not very many national indicators about who's in high school computing outside of AP as another response to the AP test question. I also might point out that it's not, CS principals may or may not be accepted as college credit, whereas AP calculus probably will.
It looks like there's a question from Jill Dominguez about who is addressing the workplace environment even when we achieve success in higher ed. How comfortable is the workplace? And I think that's an incredibly important observation. There's a lot of work to be done around ensuring that the tech workplace is actually equitable. These same exact conversations are happening at the next stage. I think it's just important to reflect that.
Mm-hmm. And if I could, go ahead.
Sorry, I was just going to jump in. I know that we're getting close on the hour. There are just a couple last minute comments / announcements I wanted to make. The first is that, thank you all for joining us. The conversation related to the tech workforce is happening in 3 weeks. Actually, might even be 2 weeks. 2 weeks. On Thursday, March 12th, related to Black women in the tech industry. So please, join us for that conversation so we can take a deeper dive into that. Wanted to reference our slide deck one final time if we could. I wanted to point out some of our really great resources that we have available through our website. And I think that slide is probably right here. We have a few newer resources that I wanted to point your attention to. Top 10 Ways to Recruit Underrepresented Undergraduate Students, that is a new resource. NCWIT 101, Introduction to Diversifying Undergraduate Computing Programs, that's also a new resource. Setting Up a Mentoring Culture for Graduate Students is also a new resource. In addition to the other resources that we have listed here that are more specific to women, Black women and girls, please, there are links here, please feel free to access these and our other resources that are, again, free and available on our NCWIT website. Just want to, I wish we had, these are the days where I miss teaching a 75-minute class because at least we have 15 more minutes to finish up our conversation. I'll be sending out, over the next couple of days, a survey to get your feedback on our conversation. Please, once you get that nudge, please fill out the survey as a way for us to have some good feedback about how you felt our conversation went today. And again, this is not the end, right? This is just the beginning of us looking at and exploring the myriad of issues facing Black women and girls and other underrepresented women and girls of color in tech. So thank you all so much for joining us today. And we hope that you all have a fabulous end of your week and a wonderful rest of your afternoons.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
So much.
Very much.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Oops.